Hello everybody, this is Russell Denton here with the ASCA League Channel, and here we are for race number 4 of the Copperhead Amateur Series at Salem. Last week we saw Nathan Lukak take home a surprising victory at Bristol in his rookie season, his third career start, which brings up the question, can we see another driver pull up a performance like that again? But before we do that, we have to go through our qualifying sessions to see which of the other teams are going to make the race here today. As we start off, duel number one, Haley Wish, who was recently dropped from the Pennzoil Pro Series, got picked up by Mally Motorsports in the Copperhead Amateur Series division, and look at this, she's already on the pole and looking to see if she can win the duel and qualify for the Copperhead Amateur race, which would be a huge bit of confidence for that driver, considering she had major struggles trying to make the Pennzoil Pro races all season long. We'll see these cars jumble up here as one of them actually gets into the wall. I believe that's Aiden Milliken. One of the good things about Salem is that it is a non-doubleheader, which means we see a lot of different drivers in this race that we wouldn't normally see when their seats are taken up by Pennzoil Pro Series races. We're watching Anthony Lopez in number 18 that would normally be driven by Zach Komoski, and we have a number of other drivers that are also driving in different seats. Here we see AJ Bain. You can see the car that would normally be painted orange is now pretty gray because they had to bring out a new car thanks to Bain crashing his at Bristol. Had a bit of trouble in the dual race and now trying to see what they can do in another bit of equipment. Back here, Push Past Motorsports was one of the back markers of the Bristol duels and really held up a lot of cars, and it looked like they were going to have a deal with Mally Motorsports to lease the number 20 team that was recently closed down due to too many teams, but looks like that's a delayed transaction as they're still running pretty slow, but at least they're not running in the back right now. We're looking at Tanya Breyer, who is just outside the cutoff spot that's currently held by Kevin Ulrich. We see a lapped car about to come into play. That's Arnold Schwabenberg, who is with Red Mustang Racing. That is the slower of the two cars that team fields, and Haley Wish has already made it by, but this pack of five is still trying to get around. Adrian Crawford goes around the outside, and now they're going to try to take the inside line, and Nicholas Way trying to push his way through as Constantine Jameson gets held up, and as 35 goes in the wall, the two car with a huge bit of momentum up the middle. We're going to see Haley Wish take the victory in this dual race, which is huge, but Jameson, huge run through the outside on the white flag lap, is going to put him in front of Wade and allow him to qualify for his first Copperhead Amateur Series race. We see the rest of the drivers making it in, including Crawford, Aiden Thomas in his first start this season, Kevin Ulrich and Jameson, as well as Wish. Nicholas Wade not going to be able to back up his performance last week, which was pretty dismal. Samantha Jones, a huge disappointment to see that she did not make the race, especially with that bad qualifying spot. And now we move on to duel number two. We see Megan Johnson about to make her way out from the pole position. Johnson did not have the best of runs here last season. There was a huge crash that really took out a lot of drivers, so that really muddied up where everyone was truly performing at that point. But Johnson's looking for some redemption with Avalon Motorsports running a full-time season in a part-time car. We see Josh Bullitt, who was one of the another one of the drivers that was left behind after Overdrive Motorsports ceased all of their teams and got picked up by Premier Racing Motorsports this week because Nia Deverett is racing in the Pennzoil Pro Series, and Bullitt holding his old number as well. Here we see Scott Roush now driving the number 37 because Alonso got moved up to the Pennzoil Pro Series, seeing if he can bring that car back to the race after winning Atlanta in the 17, but doesn't look like he's doing too well that this time around. We see William Johnson back in number 88, and it might be a little bit of a bop in the head to see that Samantha Jones did not qualify for this race. That could have been a great opportunity for Elijah Gordon to try to pounce on that points lead in the part-time division, but with Johnson in the car this time, looking to qualify for his first career race, and it doesn't look like he's going to be able to do it this time around either. We're looking at around the cutoff spot, and this is Caleb Henderson in the number 26. And Mally Motorsports has struggled to qualify for races in the Copperhead Amateur Series this season. Haley Wish obviously won the duel just before us, but now Henderson's looking to see if they can get a second car in. Obviously, they took out the number 20 car, so they're only running three part-time cars this season, or at least for the rest of the season, that is. But Henderson trying to look to the inside of another car. I believe that's Kenny Kraft, and not going to be able to pull it off. Megan Johnson's going to get out to a huge lead, and she is going to win this duel handily and get able to put herself into another race this season. We look at the final finishing results from this duel. Johnny Gardner going to make his debut race, as well as Kenny Washington and Henry Guo. Guo running Webster Zygarde's car in the non-doubleheaders, as is Gardner. And Kenny Kraft is going to make his first start as well. He made a few starts, or at least a few attempts last season, and this will be his first start in the series. And it's time for our main feature. We're going to see how the qualifying results affect how the drivers run today. As we've seen in the dual races, passing might be limited around this fast racetrack, which doesn't seem to have a distinct groove set in. Sebastian Torres with a great run and going to be on the pole and grab some very good bonus points. See five Fords in a row on the outside line, including all three of the Knight Hoffman Racing machines in places 12 through 16. Haley Wish, despite winning the first duel, is going to have a poor starting spot in 20th place, and both of the team's Zygarde cars are going to have to settle for the back two rows. Patrick Curtis also going to be in the mix back here, the last full-timer in the field. Well, they come around turn number four, and we're going to see the green flag fly right here, and we're racing at Salem. Sebastian Torres off to a great start. Kenny Kraft going to pull into second place from the outside. And Chris Dodd trying to work the outside line gets in the third early. But we do see Jeffrey Thingai is going to hit the wall early. We saw a lot of this last year. Some drivers just dig it in too deep, and they end up hitting the outside wall in either turn two or turn four. And it seems like four was more of the trouble spot, but Thingai's riding two straight top 10 finishes, seeing if he can extend that streak here today, which has so far put him in 7th place in points. That would be great for him moving forward, running a lot better than his predecessor, Jake Baskinger, now relegated basically to a red Mustang racing car. Onboard Haley Wish, we see last week's winner, Nathan Lukak, and obviously he's trying to find speed, and he found it on the outside line along with someone else in front of him, getting around Giovanni Barraza, who that was Dylan Umbrella he drafted off of. Eric Monaco with a very poor qualifying performance and really uncharacteristic of a Red Stallion racing machine. Last year he DNQ'd at Salem. That's when he was running a one-off ride with then Rick Witt Racing, now Rage Attack Racing. So it almost seems like this is kind of a trouble track for Monaco. But of course, in a lot better equipment, which Red Stallion Racing has, you'd think that he would do it at least a little bit better. But so far, he's struggling on the short tracks this season. Now looking at Robert Harrison with Smart Motorsports. Harrison with a terrible 25th place run, and that came along with his teammate Julio Caesar, both getting trapped on pit road as the rest of the field cycled through on caution pit stops. Really surprising that they ended up being so long that they couldn't make it out in time to beat out the pace car, considering neither of them were really damaged, but it was a terrible race for the team. Harrison hoping to bring it back with the number 14 machine. Looking on the back of Sebastian Torres, you can tell that that 55 car is checked out. He has left everyone else in their dust, and obviously whatever the Bob Motorsports Ford is doing today, it is really in their favor. Now looking at Johnny Gardner. He is making his first career start, and this is his first career attempt as well. That's good news for the team, which obviously wanted to field Samantha Jones for the sake of getting part-time points, but Jones obviously didn't qualify for this race. It's good to see that they got at least one team in for this time, and the 59 car is going to look to see if they can go on to victory, or at least a decent finish for Gardner in his first career start. Castle Radcliffe finished 6th at Salem last year, trying to see if he can pull off a decent performance again this year. Looks like he's just around the top 10 at this point, and he's looking to go to that outside lane. Let's see how it works for him. And yeah, he actually made a pretty good move on Julio Cesar. Seems like that outside line really works off of turn number 2. We'll see if any other drivers are able to pick that up. Patrick Curtis, a name that really went under the radar last week, not for the sake of his crash, but the fact that he pulled it back up to 6th place before the end of the race. That's pretty incredible. Being in a wreck with Dylan Mandrillo and then pulling it all the way back to 6th place. Huge run for that Rage Attack racing machine, and showing that team has speed more than we've given it credit for. Mid-race report on the screen right now. Obviously, Sebastian Torres pulling away with a big lead. That's 2.5 seconds over Kenny Kraft, who's really having a decent debut performance, running up in 2nd right now. Eric Monaco still struggling near the rear of the field. We see right here Henry Guo, another driver that is making his debut, and he is the non-doubleheader driver for Webster Zygarde's car. So far, that 12 car has only ran in one race, and that was a 26th place performance at Atlanta. So you would really like to do better on that, but currently right now, running the 26th position. So it looks like he might tie his team owner in that respect. Now looking at Red Obstrichel, two runner-up finishes in a row for that number 81 driver, and trying to see if they can extend that to 3. Currently running behind Chris Dodd and Robert Harrison, and Harrison just overtook Dodd for 3rd position. That 14 car might be finding some long run speed, but the 81 team would like to see if they can extend that points lead, which would be huge for this Blue Fair Motorsports program that had a best finish in the standings at 8th with Drischel. Looking onboard Chris Dodd, and you can see Robert Harrison really checked out after making the pass on the 8 car. And now the 14 is trying to see if he can get around the number 7 of Kenny Kraft. Definitely can't doubt that Smart Motorsports has performance in this series. But we're going to see some green flag pit stops a little bit earlier than last year, it seems like. But Torres is going to come down as well as Kraft, and that is going to hand over the lead to Robert Harrison, as it looks like the top 2 drivers are going to be the only ones that come in this lap. Looking overhead from this lit up racetrack, we see more cars coming down to take pit stops, but it looks like Harrison stays out another lap, as well as Colin Denton and Castle Radcliffe. Harrison stays out yet another lap. Now Avalon Motorsports seeing if they can work together and try to put themselves a little higher in position than they were. And we've got reports of an incident on pit road. Adrian Crawford pulling out is going to get in the way of Patrick Curtis trying to pull in, and then runs into the back of Kenny Washington as that car is just about parked. That's a huge safety issue, but 91 car got forced down there, and that is going to hold both the 22 and the 42 on pit road for an extended amount of time. But Sebastian Torres is going to be able to retain the lead, and Johnny Gardner almost came up, and that was exactly what caused the crash that put us to checkered flags last year. Glad we didn't see another one of those. But Sebastian Torres only made one start in 2016. That came at Palm Beach when running for Bad Dad Racing, who was trying to dip its toe into the Copperhead Amateur Series. This would be a huge run for the Colombian driver, as well as Bob Motorsports, which really hasn't had any decent runs in its tenure so far, running since Season 3 of the Pennzoil Pro Series. Looking at James Richardson, and this is a decent run for the number 09 car, and this could be his second career top 10. He hasn't seen a top 10 since Atlanta in 2016, the second race of the season last year, and that was fielding in his own team before that eventually merged into what's now known as Knight Hoffman Racing. And we see Patrick Curtis and Kenny Washington almost simultaneously coming out of pit road. Washington almost got into Rogers there. But a big disappointment for both the 42 team that hasn't qualified for a race this season, as well as Curtis, who might end up with just 1 point after this race. And we look on board Torres, and we see Johnny Gardner getting up into the wall. Scare right there, and it looks like the 59 car saves it. That's a pretty late scare for Torres, who's just trying to get to the end of this race clean. And he's a lap and a half away from his first career win in his fifth career start. Coming off at turn number four, he's not going to really care if anybody else passes him at this point because they're all lapped cars. Chris Dodd is miles away from Torres at this point. All the 55 car needs to do is bring it around this corner clean, and he is home free. And he's going to do that. Sebastian Torres with his first career victory here tonight at Salem. And that's going to get the first victory in Bob Motorsports' career. Huge night for the team owner as well. Sebastian Torres is going to be the one that gets to burn down the tires here tonight at Salem. As we look at the final finishing results from this one, Sebastian Torres with his first career victory. Chris Dodd with a great second place run to really nullify some bad runs to start off the season. Zrischel's not going to be able to make it three straight runner-up finishes in a row, have to settle for third. And Kenny Kraft with a great start to his career with a fourth place finish here tonight. Looking at the back half of the field, Nathan Lukacs going to have to be settling for 16th place after his victory last week. Eric Monaco with his worst finish of the season so far in 22nd. We also see Kenny Washington and Patrick Curtis really affected by those pit road incidents. They finished five laps down in this one. And as we look at the point standings, Zrischel's going to do nothing but extend the points lead with that third place finish. After Lukacs and Barraza had pretty terrible performances, Torres is going to be able to make it up to second place in the standings because he was pretty far up there to start with, but still 31 points back. And Samantha Jones will retain the points lead in the part-time division. Further back, we have a lot of part-time drivers here, and Adrian Crawford had the best points position among those drivers coming into this race, but really failed to capitalize. Going to get passed up by Kenny Kraft and Megan Johnson. And Alexander Rowe continues to be the only full-time driver who hasn't cracked the top 28 this season. That's going to do it for us, and we will see you next week when we head to Lucas Oil Raceway, and we'll see you all then. Every